So just a quick summary of the phase lock loop. So I typically use a type 2 loop, that is the loop filter also has a pole at the origin, okay, that's the meaning of a type 2 loop. So because of that integration, you don't need a phase difference to support the control voltage of the VCO, okay. And because of stability reasons, the VCO itself is an integrator, so you need to have a zero and a pole at the origin, okay. So this is the form of the transfer function, you will have some constants. And you can have extra poles to filter out reference feed through, okay. So that's basically it, and this gives you a bandwidth of the bandwidth of the PLL. This is the bandwidth of the phase transfer function of the PLL. What this shows is, if you have a phase error at the input, let's say you have a step in the input phase, how long the output takes to respond, that is related to this bandwidth, okay. So this is related to the settling time when you are switching channels, how quickly it settles, etc., etc. Okay. And we saw that for the PLL that we discussed, it is okay. So many radians per second. So this assumes a well-designed PLL where the zero is before the unity gain, the additional poles are after the unity gain frequency and so on. And this type of PLL gives you a low pass transfer function from input phase to output phase, okay, and a high pass transfer function from the VCO phase to output phase. So by changing the bandwidth, you can control the amount of VCO jitter that goes out versus the amount of input jitter that goes to the output of the phase lock loop. Okay. And it also, from some intermediate points, it can be band pass. That is, if you have noise added to the control node. Now this is a transfer function between a voltage and output phase, so it will have some dimensions, but it will have attenuation at DC as well as at very high frequencies. Okay. So this part is clear to everyone, how we got this. So you start with the model of the PLL, then you derive the incremental model, and then you can mechanically derive all of the transfer functions.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. So, in a linear system, let's say you start from some value, and if it's a first order system, it goes down as exponential. And if you start from a smaller value, it goes down like this. Now, if you are looking for a fixed amount of error, yeah, it depends both on the time constant of the filter as well as the point at which you start. Okay. So you take the worst case. That's what you do. Like when you are switching and so on, you take the worst case step that you apply. So now the amount of time required to settle to a given fraction of the starting value is the same for both the cases. You take 1% of this and 1% of this, that will happen somewhere at a fixed time. But typically, yeah, you're right that you are interested in a fixed amount of error from the ideal value or the from the steady state value, and that, yeah, that if you have a small disturbance, it will die down quicker, and if you have a large disturbance, it will die down faster. So when you say settling time, it is basically specified with respect to the worst case, whatever the worst case is. It could be that you have a band of channels and you have to switch from the first channel to the last one. Okay. Anything else? Now, if we have a, we can make a clock and data recovery circuit using a hog phase detector. So, what we have done is to simply replace the three state phase detector using this. Okay. The advantage of this is it does both the recovery of the clock phase as well as it gives you the recovered data. The output of the flip flop gives you the recovered data. Okay. So if the system is working correctly, you will get the data output and the clock output. The data output will be a nice rectangular stuff. Basically it is retimed by the flip flop and the clock will be in the center of data. Okay. So now you can use this as input to some other system. Okay, yeah, I'll do that. Let me just finish the summary. Now, because this and the hog phase detector also has an average output that is linear with the input phase difference. Here we are talking about phase difference between the input data and the clock edge, that is the rising edge of the clock, let's say. Now, but the issue with the random data is not all transitions need be present. I mean, otherwise it's not random data. So, the equations governing the clock and data recovery circuit remain more or less the same as the phase lock loop, except for the addition of the density factor. There is a certain transition density in the random data, so you have to multiply the phase detector gain with that. Okay. So, this is still a linear approximation. Okay. So, the linear approximation works, and if you have a low transition density, you will have lower bandwidth, etc., etc. The entire loop gain goes down if you have lower transition density, because you are comparing only during transitions, whereas with a periodic input, you are comparing at every transition. Now, so what happens is if, so loop gain is proportional to transition density. So essentially all the expressions remain the same, except wherever you have the phase detector gain, you also have the multiplying factor, which is the transition density. Okay. Now, every clock and data recovery circuit works only with a certain constraint on the consecutive identical digits. That is simply because you can't measure phase if you don't have any transitions. Now, the limit can be very large so that you don't have to worry about, but it will always be there. Okay. So, this depends on like various things like leakage and noise in the disturbances in the circuit and so on. So basically the VCO is operating away from the desired frequency, right? There is only one exact frequency of the data. The VCO is operating away from it. So even if it is operating slightly away, the phase error will keep on accumulating. A frequency error is the same as a ramp like phase error. Okay. So the phase error will keep accumulating and at some point become too much. It will become too much to retime the data. Okay. So that amount of time for which the error remains within bounds, that is that gives you the limit on the number of consecutive identical digits. Okay. And this is a property of every CDR, not just this particular phase detector. So this gives you both So the analysis is more or less similar to this, and the other distinction is typically you don't have a divider in the feedback path because you are supposed to recover the clock frequency, which is the frequency of the data. So there is no divider, you just recover the frequency with a ratio of 1. Yeah, it can be. Yeah, I mean, see, the free running frequency is a kind of arbitrary definition, meaning it's like the bias point of the circuit, right? You can choose anything to be the bias point of the circuit, and then you consider disturbances around it. Free running frequency is like that. So let's say your loop filter output is 0.9 volts. I mean, it goes between 0 and 1.8 volts. So you can take 0.9 to be the bias point, and it goes above by 0.9 and below by 0.9. So the VCO will oscillate at a certain frequency when it's given a voltage of 0.9 volts. You call that the free running frequency, and then you do the analysis around it. But the analysis doesn't change if you define the output at 1.2 volts to be the free running frequency, okay? Then it will be asymmetric, that's all. It's just like choosing the, choosing some other bias point and analyzing the circuit. The effect will be the same. Any questions on this? Oh, yeah. So we can have, that's what, it can have additional poles. So that's the, that's what I wrote. You can have one or more poles to attenuate the reference feed through. Typically you find that there is no point putting like 5 or 6 poles. Because what happens is if you put more poles, it will introduce more phase shifts and it may degrade the stability. So, for it to not degrade the stability, you have to increase the frequency of the poles. If you do that, the attenuation from them reduces. Okay? So, if you evaluate it and see, so maybe you can have, let's say, 2 poles here, and maybe you can have 3 poles here, which give you the same degradation of stability. So, if you look at this frequency, actually the attenuation from 3 poles is the same as attenuation from the 2 poles. So it may not be beneficial to increase the number of poles, because you can't just increase the number of poles, you also have to increase their frequencies. Okay. Typically what you find is 1 or 2 poles. 1 pole you can certainly put, because even implementation wise it's very easy. This is your proportional plus integral loop filter. A current pumping into that will give you the proportional integral path, and you simply add another capacitor. So this almost comes for free. So, but to make one more pole, perhaps you can do something of this sort. Okay. First of all, with a 3-state phase detector, the lock range is infinite, right? Because if you with an XOR phase detector, the phase detection range is, I mean, the any phase detector, the phase detection range is limited. Now, with a type 1 PLL, the control voltage, when it's away from 0 or when the VCO is oscillating away from free running frequency, you need a phase offset at the input of the phase detector. Okay? Now, in case of a type 2 PLL, you don't need that. So, the lock range theoretically is infinity. No, not capture range may not be. Actually, capture range is also infinity, because when you have different input frequencies, the it will give you a non-zero average value. So capture range refers to so it's basically something that has to do with the speed at which you change the frequency, right? So let's say you are operating at 1 gigahertz, then you change it to 1 gigahertz plus 1 hertz, that is you slowly vary it, then the PLL will kind of pull the VCO to follow the input frequency. Okay? So that is lock range, that is more like a quasi-static variation. Whereas capture ranges, you apply a step and then see if it captures it or not. Or when you start up the PLL, whether it goes to the right frequency or not. So it is, the only difference is whether you are changing the input very quickly or very slowly. So this is, for lock range, you consider quasi-static variations. Okay? That is, quasi-static means that you apply the change so slowly that you can assume that it is reaching steady state at every point along the path. Okay? That is quasi-static. So clearly you can imagine that the lock range will be, the capture range will be smaller than the lock range, because the VCO, I mean when you change the input frequency, the VCO may be pulled to a certain frequency, but then if you change the same, if you apply a rapid step, it may not be able to acquire the control voltage. Okay. No, see, that's what, in case of an XOR gate, what happens is, not XOR gate, I mean a type 1 PLL. So, you have a certain so in this case, the range here can be, let's say, plus minus pi. Okay, so the range of voltages here is plus minus pi times KPD. So the range of VCO frequencies that can be covered, the range of VCO, the range over which the VCO can be tuned, is the free running frequency of the VCO plus pi times KPD times KVCO. Okay. Now this has nothing to do with the limitation of the VCO. The VCO itself may be tunable over a much wider range, but you are not able to provide control voltages beyond this range. Okay, this is a limitation on the lock range. But this doesn't apply to a type 2 PLL. Is it clear why? This limitation does not apply to a type 2 PLL. Yeah, so if you have also an additional integral path, the range of this is plus minus pi, but it doesn't have to go to plus minus pi, this will always be 0. Okay, so the integral integrator output will supply whatever control voltage is required. So the lock range is infinity in theory if you have this type of system. Usually it comes about, the limitation in lock range comes about because of the limitation in the tuning range of the VCO. You can't make it a VCO that tunes over infinite range. So that's more of a practical thing, that depending on your supply voltage range and so on, and the architecture of the VCO that you choose, you can only tune from, let's say, 5 gig to 10 gig or something of that sort. So you can't have a VCO that tunes over an infinite range. That's why the lock range limitation comes in. Okay. Or, I mean, this voltage also cannot go over an infinite range. In practice, that's because you operate with a finite supply, and any signal with an active circuit will be bounded to that supply. So the limitations are more practical. It's not because of the range of the phase detector. Yeah. Yeah. Not necessarily. See, that depends on the type of phase detector. Now, in case of a three-state phase detector, if the input frequencies are different, what happens is it will give you a DC, or it will give you a non-zero average. Okay. So, because it gives you a non-zero average, it will keep steering the VCO in that direction. Okay. So, in case of a three-state phase detector, the three-state phase detector is also a phase frequency detector, because it gives you a definite indication of whether the frequency, whether one of the frequencies is higher than the other or lower than the other. Okay. Well, I mean, both can be infinity, right? One can be less. Now, in case of the type 1 PLL gives you a limitation of lock range. Now, it certainly cannot capture something beyond that, right? Isn't it? So, let's say I am operating at F0 and I apply a step F0 plus delta F, where delta F is greater than this. It certainly cannot capture it. Even like however long you apply, it just cannot do it. That's all. So it's either less than or equal to, maybe I should. Yeah. Yeah, it will not work. I mean, it will stop here. Right? When the input frequency, let's say you are talking about a PLL with no divider in the feedback. Okay, so the output frequency is the same as the input frequency. So I start with F0. This will be 0 volts and this will be F0. Now I increase the input frequency very slowly. This voltage will go on increasing, and so does the phase difference between these two. Okay, at some point this phase difference will go beyond the range of the phase detector, and the voltage won't increase anymore. It will flip back to zero, right? If you remember the characteristics of the phase detector, it can be something like this, some modular characteristic. So beyond this, it will just lose lock. Okay, so, and if it cannot lock, it can certainly not capture. Now again, if every component is operating ideally with a three-state phase detector, the capture range is also infinity, because when one frequency is greater than the other, it will give you a non-zero DC, which will keep steering the VCO in that direction. Okay, if the input frequency is greater than this, if the input frequency is greater than the fed back frequency, the output average will be more than zero. So it will steer the VCO, which will again come back. It will steer the VCO some more and so on. Is that okay or no? Then the limitation will come because of the limitations on the voltage of this. Okay, the phase detector won't give you infinitely large output, right? It will give you at most a certain maximum output based on the supply voltage and so on. So when we say the A and B output, I mean the up and down output go to plus or minus 1, that plus and plus 1 represents some voltage. Okay, so if you go beyond that, you can't go beyond that one. So there may be limitations because of that, because of the limitation in the voltage range here and so on. Okay, but technically, because you have an integrator here, you can just capture anything you want. Okay. Now the difference between the capture and lock range is very sharp when you talk about an XOR gate. When you have an XOR gate as a phase detector, when the input frequencies are different, the output average is zero. Okay, so it will really not steer the VCO in any definite direction. Okay, so what happens is when you have a small step, it will get steered to one direction, and then that will come back as feedback and get steered further in the same direction and so on. Okay. So without any other practical limitations, the lock and capture range of a type 2 PLL with a phase frequency detector is infinite. So there are practical limitations, can be many things. Firstly, the voltage limitation. Okay, so the control voltage cannot go to infinite range. And secondly, the VCO itself has a limited range. You can't make a VCO with infinite range. And also the other thing is the frequency of operation of the phase frequency detector. Okay, the phase frequency detector is supposed to give you up and down pulses. Now, as the input frequency becomes larger and larger, these won't be nice square pulses anymore. They can become smaller pulses. In that case, it's really not measuring the phase difference very well. Okay, it's like the phase detector gain is very small. So those things come into picture. Okay, the phase frequency detector and the charge pump have some frequency limitations. Okay, you can't switch on and off the current source very rapidly. So if you design something for 100 megahertz and you, let's say the VCO is not the limit, nothing else is the limit, you just apply 1 gigahertz to it, maybe the phase frequency detector itself is not detecting the phase properly. Okay, that can happen. So those are the things that will limit the range, and typically it is this, especially at high frequencies you use LC oscillators. And LC oscillators can't be tuned very easily, right? You have to tune the capacitor to tune it, and you can't tune the capacitor over a very wide range. Anything else? Yeah. That's because for small changes in frequency you can do it. See, here it is unbounded, right? When you have the question is if the input and output frequencies are different, when the PLL is not in lock, you can't use the linear model. Okay. So the way we derived the model was, basically you can't model the phase detector. That is the problem, right? You can't model the phase detector in a, when you have different frequencies, you can't say that the phase detector output is proportional to the phase difference. That is the main issue. Okay, that's why it becomes nonlinear. So when you have same frequencies, then the output of the phase detector is some periodic signal, but we model the average output of it. Okay, and that is proportional to the phase difference. When you have different frequencies, the phase difference between them, let's say like this and this are both fixed frequencies. Okay, the phase of one of them is like this, the other one is like this. So the difference may be, difference is also a ramp. Now if you apply this type of phase difference, which is, now the range of this is important. If this is, the range of this is very small, then the output of the phase detector can be considered linear. So for small changes you can do that. So that is like when you apply a small step, what happens is, how does the PLL lock? Let's say the PLL is in lock state, and then you step the phase of the input. That is, the input is supposed to be periodic, okay? And let's say the output has locked to the input. Now after this, I mean, I imply that these are all equally spaced, okay? Then you apply a phase step. What I mean by that is, you have one interval where it is longer, and then it is the same as before. Okay, this is like the frequency here is the same as the frequency here, but there is a phase step. So how does it? How does the PLL acquire lock in this case? What happens is the VCO frequency has to change. Now you have a delay, so the VCO frequency will lower just a little bit in this period, and it will lower a little more, and it will lower a little more, and finally it will get itself aligned with it. So during this period, the VCO frequency will be lower than the input frequency, and then it will acquire lock. So this type of thing can be modeled. Although here also the VCO frequency is different from the input frequency, you can model the small changes using the linear model. When this range becomes well beyond 2 pi, okay, when the frequency difference is significant, then the output of the phase detector is not a linear. The average output of the phase detector is not a linear. Not a multiple of this. That's why you can't model it. Okay. Any other questions on the PLL? The output of the equalizer will be fed to the clock recovery. Okay? And also if you have a little bit of ISI, it is okay. So the question is, how do you do both equalization and clock recovery? Now, one thing is you have your feedforward equalizer and you have a clock recovery after that. Now your feedforward equalizer itself may need the clock. So that is possible, but that is okay. I mean, you just have to design the equalizer so that it's not very sensitive to this type of stuff. Okay? So typically the output of the equalizer goes to the clock recovery. Sometimes you do the clock recovery first and then the equalization afterwards. That's also possible. Yeah? Yeah. If we assume that the XOR gate gives out, square wave meaning not necessarily 50% duty cycle, a rectangular wave. If the XOR gate has zero rise time and fall times, or XOR gate or any phase detector, it has zero rise and fall times, it will be a rectangular pulse. The EFT will be a rectangular pulse. I can't hear that. So if we assume lock condition, it is. Because if we assume lock condition, we imagine that the input and the output, the input and the feedback frequencies are the same. Now both inputs to the phase detector are periodic, the output will be periodic. Is that okay? Yeah, it is. So all that analysis again holds only in the lock condition. So if you have, let's say this is the input, the A input to the phase detector, and B is delayed by some amount in the lock condition. This is what happens in a type 1 PLL. So the output will be okay. So this is TREF. So it is periodic with FREF. Yeah. 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 Uh-huh. Yeah. 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 Yeah, that's correct. So what happens is the VCO, that's a good point, that now the VCO output is not at a, VCO input is not DC, the VCO input has disturbances, so the VCO output is not proportional to the average value, right? I mean, it's not just a function of the average value. So if you look at the components in the VCO output, ideally it should be at n times FREF, okay? Now in reality it will have components which are FREF away from it, okay, n plus 1, n minus 1 and so on. Now if you look at it, this is periodic with FREF. It's not periodic with n times FREF. Even the VCO output is periodic only with FREF. Okay? So it is true that the two inputs to the phase detector are still periodic with FREF. Yeah, overall you still have periodicity but only with FREF. You would want the output of the PLL to be periodic with n times FREF, but it is periodic with FREF. What happens is the component at n times FREF is the strongest and all the others are. Yeah. Yeah, that's right. Yeah, that by definition has a zero average. No, it will matter. What it will do is it will create these disturbances, right? So if you, if, yeah? Yeah, that's correct. The average is zero, but so basically the, what I am stressing here is the VCO output. If everything was ideal, the VCO output would be periodic with n times FREF, but it's periodic only with FREF. Okay? So if you look at it, you will have the VCO output and all these cycles should have been the same as each other. What happens is if you look at n cycles, these n cycles will be the same as the next n cycles, but each of these cycles will not be equal to each other. Okay? So that's the result of this disturbance. Now it just, of course, in a well-designed system, you want the component at n FREF to be the strongest and these below a certain value, okay? Is that okay? Yeah. 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 No, that also works in some cases. See, when you have intersymbol interference, the ideal data, let's say, looks like this, okay, something like this. Now, the actual data in case of intersymbol interference will have zero crossings at different points, maybe, okay, maybe something like this, okay. Now, in the ideal case, the spacing between any two zero crossings is an integer multiple of the bit period. In case of data with ISI, that's not true. So, if you feed such a data to clock recovery circuit, it will also give you an output clock which also has jitter. Okay? It will track this jitter to some extent and it will do it. Now, if this jitter becomes too much, you will not be able to recover the clock. Okay? So, if you have, let's say, zero I opening, then it may be difficult to recover the clock. So, but what happens typically is the signal to noise ratio required for good clock recovery is much smaller than the signal to noise ratio required to detect the data very well. Okay? So let's say the signal to noise ratio is such that the BER is of the order of 10 to the minus 3. Okay? This is good enough to recover the clock typically. I mean, that also depends on the particular shape. I mean, you can have BER of 10 to the minus 3 in various ways, right? You can have ideal data like this and you can have a lot of noise. Or you can have a lot of ISI and you have some noise. So, in many cases, when you have BER of 10 to the minus 3, you can still recover the clock. Whereas, in a broadband communication link, like let's say the optic fiber link or something, for the data itself, you are looking for bitter rates of 10 to the minus 12, 10 to the minus 15 and so on. Okay. So, it is okay to, let's say your input data has a lot of ISI, but it still has, let's say roughly speaking, this type of quality. So, you can do clock and data recovery on this. You use the clock from this, you don't use the data, because the data will have a bitter rate of 10 to the minus 3. And then you have an equalizer, and you can use the clock that you recovered in the equalizer if you wish, and get data here, which has 10 to the minus 12 bitter rate. Okay. So, there is a chicken and egg problem when you do equalization and clock recovery, but it can be done. And what helps it particularly is the fact that the clock and data recovery needs a much lower quality signal than the equalizer itself. And you can even do the other way, you can do equalization and after that you can do clock and data recovery and feed the clock back from this. Okay. So, initially it will all be not working properly. Perhaps the clock and data recovery circuit locks faster. Okay. You arrange the equalizer such that it is not doing any equalization. That is, it has taps of 0, 1, 0, 0, 0, 0 and so on. So, then it is not doing any equalization. Then the CDR will work out of the unequalized data. And we will also say that the bandwidth of the CDR is much higher than the bandwidth of the adaptation. That is, the time constant of CDR is much smaller than the time constant you use for adapting the equalizer. So, then the CDR will work first. I mean, you can, of course, everything is working simultaneously, but this will lock quickly and then you can use that recovered clock to adapt the data. Okay. Now, actually, there is a very important class of equalizers that we didn't consider. We didn't have time to do that. We considered only if the symbol period is T, all our FIR equalizers had a delay of T. Now, this is not necessary. Okay, in some cases, in fact, this is not the best thing to do. So, this is known as a symbol spaced equalizer. Okay, this is you delay the data by one symbol period, I mean integer multiples of symbol period, and you wait and add them, and you get rid of ISI. Okay, so that is one possibility, but you can have e to the minus st by 2 also. So, something like this is known as a fractionally spaced equalizer. Okay. Now, what I mean is, let us say the channel impulse response, channel pulse response is something like this. And we convert this to a discrete time channel. That is how we analyzed it and we came up with discrete time equalizers. Now, let me draw that model again. We feed a pulse to the channel and let's say the pulse starts at t equal to 0. Okay. And you have sampling at integer multiples of t. So, the timing of this is n times t plus some phase offset, some delay td. Okay. Now, in the assignments and so on, I bypass this issue of the effect of TD by choosing TD to be the peak, right? You choose TD so that you are sampling at the peak. Now, what it turns out that if you have a symbol spaced equalizer, it is very sensitive to TD. Okay, what you can imagine that let's say you didn't have any channel, okay, or you had the channel response was something like this. It just happened to be something like this. Okay, now you can sample here, here and here, or maybe you can sample here and here. So, in that case you get small signals. So, that is not the, so I mean I can't explain it very superficially like this, but with some kind of vague signal shape you can imagine that if you shift TD you can end up getting a small signal and a poor performance. Okay. Now, a fractionally spaced equalizer is much more immune to this, because if you can sample here, okay, So this is half the period, or you can sample here, which is half the period. So there is not that much difference between these two. This is a very vague explanation. This is not exactly right, but with a fractionally spaced equalizer, the clock recovery works very well. With a symbol spaced equalizer, the clock recovery, I mean, the channel model is very dependent on the phase of the sampling clock, and so the clock recovery and the equalizer may not work very well together. Okay, it is just more sensitive. It's more sensitive to the clock phase. So it will, which sort of equalizer, the symbol space? No, that's what we saw, right? I mean, if you have, if you plot the eye diagram, okay, it will look something like this. Now, what are you doing in the Hogg phase detector? You are looking for the transitions, right? So if the eye diagram was ideal, it will be exactly half away from the transition. If the eye diagram has a lot of jitter, on average the clock will be centered here, but you will also have jitter in the recovered clock. Is that okay? Is that what you asked? So with input jitter, the output recovered clock will also have jitter. Okay. But the Hogg phase detector just look for the midpoint. I mean, I am assuming that the flip flops that you use in the Hogg phase detector can slice this data even if it is not at the maximum amplitude, right? If it is able to do that, then there will be, then it will recover the clock. Now, there is always the issue of what happens very close to the transition when the signal is nearly zero. Then it will respond to the noise and so on. It will make some wrong decisions. But on average, it will work. Do we have to do this? No. See, the eye diagram is just a way of visualizing what the data looks like or what the clock looks like. Okay? That is, basically you want periodic signals. I mean, in case of data, the data itself is not periodic, but all the transitions are at integer multiples of TV. So, this will give you very qualitatively what, how far it is from that ideal. Okay? Yeah. No, not the picture of the eye diagram. Are you talking about analysis or whether the circuit works or not? No, circuit doesn't know anything about the eye diagram, right? I mean, it simply looks at, if you look at the, maybe now this is a good time to revise the Hogg phase detector. So let's say the flip-flops are very sensitive now. Okay, if it is slightly positive or negative, it will give you the full decision. So this was the circuit we came up with. Okay, so the data can be, I mean, practically anything. Maybe it has smooth transitions. So let's say these are symbol intervals and so on. Okay. Now I am assuming that the XOR and the D flip flop have a good enough sensitivity. Okay. It can't, of course, if it's exactly zero, it won't be able to slice it. But if it is either slightly positive or negative, it will give you full values, full logical levels. Now you apply the clock here. Okay. So it is going to, if the clock edge appears here, it is going to retime it to the clock edge, right? So, and if I pass these through two to the XOR, what I get will be, whenever there is a difference, I get something like this, okay? So at every transition, I get a pulse whose width equals the data. Now what happens if this data doesn't have sharp edges, it has smooth edges, that means that the XOR output will be somewhat smooth and the average may be less than what we calculated. In case of a rectangular pulses, we saw that the average was pi by 2 pi. Okay. If you have smoothened out waveforms, you will have something less than this. That is like reducing the phase detector gain, but it's there nonetheless. Okay. and you want to make it log to the middle, so you want to calculate the output corresponding to half width. Now you don't want to just assume that it will be some fixed value, you use the same flip flops to generate that. Okay, so this will be half width pulses. So you use these as up and down signals and these go to a charge pump, right? Okay, so there is a resistor also. So if up width is more than down width, the voltage across the capacitor will monotonically increase, will increase in the long term. And if up is less than down, up width is less than down width, the voltage across the capacitor will decrease in the long term. So that will tune the VCO. Okay, the steady state is reached when the width of up and down are the same, which means that this is a half width, which means that the clock as clock is aligned to the middle of data. Okay, so it's not the eye diagram is something that we use for analysis. It's just overlapping of successive periods of data. Now what happens in the circuit is at every edge you get a pulse, and based on the pulse it will push the VCO one way or the other, and it will reach steady state when the up and down pulses are pushing it equally on this way and that way. That is the steady state. Okay, but in every cycle it does push it one way or the other way. Does it answer the question? Yeah. No, what I said was, see, let's say, let me draw it with neat rectangular pulses. Let's say this is my data, okay? And my clock is shifted. So don't pay attention to the duty cycle of this. And I take my rising edge as the one I want. Okay. Did I miss an edge? Okay. This is fine. Now I retime the data with this clock. So I get something like this. Okay. Now if I XOR these two, I get positive output. What I want is, what I want to feed to the phase detector should have zero when the difference between this edge and this edge is 5, right? So that's why I want to subtract it. Is that okay? So if I just plot, okay, let me XOR these two, I get these pulses, okay? And I plot the average value of this, it will always be positive, right? Because I'm assuming this will go from 0 to 1. But I want the phase detector input to be 0 when the phase difference is pi. So I have to just move it. So this is the average output of the phase detector. And if I magically knew this DC value and I could obtain a DC source of this value, I could simply subtract it. Because this depends on the implementation of the flip-flop, the output levels it rises to, and those things also change with process temperature and whatnot, I would like to generate it in the same way that I generated these pulses. Okay? So that's why I do that. Yeah, that's correct. So essentially I have moved this characteristic to this value, right? So if the phase difference is less than pi, it is here. So it will go to this point. If it is more than pi, it is here and it will come to this. No, there is nothing profound in this. It's just that I want zero input to the phase detector at some particular phase offset. I arrange it by doing this. Okay? No, why? No. So, one question, let me ask you something. So, here I said, I assume 0 and 1. Why can't I just make this minus 1 and 1 and be done with it? Is that okay? If I make it minus 1 and 1, it will be high for half, plus 1 for half a period and minus 1 for the remaining half, and it will be 0, right? It will have zero average when the phase difference is pi. Why did I not do that instead of going to generate another output? Huh? Oh, that's okay. I mean, that's a... That's okay. I'll say minus 1 of this is the down, right? I mean, if it is plus 1, it's up. Minus 1, it is down. I can easily make that, isn't it? I can always have something like this. And the logic controlling this is inverted, that's all. That's not the issue. Which one? No, it won't, right? Because if you have a smaller phase difference, you will have this. The average value of this is negative. And if you have a larger phase difference, the average value is positive. It will in fact give you this curve, or will it? No, that is true anyway, right? I mean, so we assume, we have to assume that the clock duty cycle is 50%. Yeah. So if you have consecutive identical digits, you will have minus 1, which will pull the VCO in some direction. So that's why you can't do that. You have to have 0 when there are, from the beginning we said that to detect phase differences when one of the signals is random data, the output should be deactivated when you have consecutive identical digits. That won't happen. If I do this, I will simply get something like this. This time, this will make the VCO drift away to some frequency. Yeah, that's true. For anything it will do. It will work only if you have, if the input is periodic. Yeah. Anything else? Okay. Yeah. Yeah, so that is another, yeah, that's something you have to consider. So basically your data is like this and your clock is very close to the rising edge. Okay? What happens then? So we discussed like setup time and hold time, so it may not be able to make a good decision. So, but that is okay because so here it may make a wrong decision once in a while. Okay, the first flip flop may make a wrong decision. Okay, so the XOR output will not have, I mean the XOR output may not have time to rise, or maybe D flip flop output itself may not have time to rise, but the second one will give you a large negative value, right? So that's why it works, because the second one is clocked by, now the second one's clock is in the middle of the data. Okay, so this will give you a large, this will always give you the half pulse, whereas this will give you a small average. Now what happens is the non-linearity in the phase detector, the output, we say that it is pi by 2 pi, the output average, that won't be the case unless you have very sharp rise and fall. Okay, so what happens when the clock approaches this, what happens when the clock approaches this edge is that the output of the flip-flop may not rise fully, so the up signal may not rise fully. So the average of the up signal will not follow this, it will not be 5 by 2 pi, it will be something smaller than that. But that's okay because up minus down will still be negative, it will steer the VCO in the right direction. Okay, it will keep moving the clock away from the edge. Is that okay? Is that convincing or no? So what happens in reality is that the phase detector, the average of the up signal is supposed to do this, right? It should give you pi over 2 pi versus pi. So in reality what happens is, because of finite rise times and so on, firstly the gain may be smaller, okay? And when it comes close to pi equal to 0, the output will be almost 0, because the output of the flip-flop does not rise and the output of the XOR doesn't rise to a rectangular pulse. Now what we are evaluating is this minus this value, right? Meaning this is average of up, but the average of down will be always this one, Okay, that is fixed. So the difference curve, instead of being this, will have a slightly weird shape. Maybe it has a smaller gain. It will have something like this. So what is important that is that it be negative. Okay, if it is negative, it will steer the VCO in the right direction. And once it comes somewhere here, it will be okay. Is that okay? So the phase detector characteristics will be non-linear because of these non-idealities of the flip-flop and the XOR gate, so on. How can we add reset to the flip-flop? Oh, to make the phase frequency three-state detector.
Yeah, so maybe I can just show you if I have.
So it's actually a simple circuit. So you can make a full-fledged flip-flop with reset. I think that you probably know from your digital design classes. But in this case, the peculiarity is that the D input is always tied to 1. Okay. So this is always tied to 1. So you don't need to make a full flip-flop. There is some simple circuit that is used very frequently. Let me try to find it in this.
This one. What is the full screen? Oh.
So this is essentially used two SR latches in some feedback to get you this one. So this doesn't have the explicit D input, okay? The D input connected to one is implicit in the circuit. So if you made a full flip-flop with reset, you will need a lot more gates than this. So you can use this circuit instead. And I mean, you can make a corresponding realization using AND gates. Okay. That depends on the frequency of the gates. So, maximum frequency of the phase frequency detector? Yeah, so that depends entirely on the speed of the gates. So, as you make faster and faster gates, it can go faster and faster. But with, even with pure like regular CMOS gates without any special design, you can go up to many hundreds of megahertz or gigahertz. Also, what happens is this is used in a frequency synthesizer, and generally the input frequency will be limited to, let's say, a couple of hundred megahertz, because you are talking about scenarios where you are trying to synthesize a high output frequency from a crystal oscillator, and crystal oscillators are limited to maybe 100 megahertz, 200 megahertz, that type of stuff. So the speed of this is not an issue, but I mean, yeah, you can always have a situation where the input frequency itself is in multi gigahertz. In which case you have to make a more complicated implementation or go for a different phase detector. For what? Yeah. Yeah, you can do it. See, there is a logical design of a flip-flop with reset, right, that I think you can find from your digital books. And you can use any family of logic to implement that. It may become too complicated and sometimes it may be inefficient, etc. But you can certainly do that. So if you, I don't remember exactly how you make latches with reset, but it involves like more combinations when you, so for instance, the SR latch, if you tie both inputs to 0, it will retain the old state, but if you tie one of them to 1, it will force the output to 0, etc. That's the principle behind reset also. So you'll have multiple input gates and some combination there to get that. That is one thing. So you can take the logic diagram and translate it to some realization, okay, using any logic family that you wish. But if you are designing at the transistor level on an IC, you can basically put transistors anywhere you want. So, latch is something like this, okay. In its basic form, a latch is basically two inverters connected back to back. This you know, right? This will have a stable operating point with this being high, this being low, or vice versa. So that is those represent two states of the latch. Now let's say this is Q and this is Q bar, and you want to reset it. So that means that Q should become 0 and Q bar should become 1. So you can have transistors in parallel. Okay. So this is reset, this is reset bar. So as long as reset is high, it will hold Q and Q bar to 0. Okay. Oh, sorry. I think we should wind up. It's already 12.